Good morning. I can tell you're back. I told Pastor Kevin this morning it's a good day. It's a good day for everybody to be wearing blue and gold. You can't go wrong if you're wearing blue and gold today. But if you're wearing scarlet and gray, I'm sorry about your luck. It's a great day. Pastor Kevin insists that this song is not a Christmas song. But we've been singing this song since I was a kid at Christmas. Forever. Well, he knows more about this kind of stuff than I do. But we're going to sing it anyway. We don't have to sing it at Christmas. We can sing it anytime. Let's sing Joy to the World. Let's stand and sing. Explain this. When he comes again and he rules the world after the rapture come and after, that's what that song is all about.
Put up the first verse.
Yeah.
So joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive what?
Our king.
When he came the first time, did they receive him as king?
No.
When are they going to receive him as king? When he comes back in the millennium. That's why I say it's not a Christmas song. I understand why we sing it at Christmas. It's a fun song to sing at Christmas. And it brings joy to the world. But it's not a Christmas song. So I'll give up my soapbox.
But that's okay.
Let he.
But that, you know what? That's okay. It's good. We sang it, and it's good. And it's all about praise to the King anyway. It's all about praise to the King. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for today. Just thank you for your blessings. Thank you for us being able to be here this morning. Thank you for everything that you've done for us. Father, you're so great. You're so good. We can't even repay you. No amount of things we can do can repay you. Thank you for your unconditional love. That we can't do anything more or we can't do anything less to make you love us more and love us less. God, we just ask now that you speak to our hearts. Holy Spirit, you're here in our midst. We ask you to have right away in each and every heart. Speak to hearts this morning, and if there's one here that needs you or they need to grow closer to you, we ask that you'd speak to them, and we pray for Pastor Kevin as he brings a message this morning, that you would fill him with your spirit and give him freedom to speak. Now, Father, we ask that you be with us the remainder of the service. May we praise your holy name, for only you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen. This is I call this my Andy Griffith song. Do you remember when Andy Griffith at his Christmas special, and Ben was trying to run somebody out, and Ben kept trying to get into the jail, and Andy and it wasn't Helen at the time. It was she was Eleanor Donahue. She played on Father Knows Best, but she played Ellie. She played Ellie, and they sang this song. So let's do it.
Away in a manger, a crib for a bed, the little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay.
Said about a cappella singing. It's beautiful. We need to praise God. And this is Sarepta's song this morning. Because you hear music all week long and you think, man, I like to sing that Sunday morning. And if you ever get that point, let me know. I got a couple that I'm waiting for you, Melanie. We're going to do. But this was Sarepta's song she kept singing all week long, so we're going to sing it this morning, and it fits right in with the service.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that rescue the souls of men. Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit, we long to
Children, you are dismissed to go out back or downstairs. Not anywhere. No, we are not setting you free. Not today. Adults and those who want to be adults, turn to 1 Peter chapter 3. I want to draw your attention to two things this morning. One is 1 Peter chapter 3, and the second one came in your bulletins that you received this morning. In your bulletins you received this morning, this little pamphlet and this offering envelope. This is the week that we begin to pray for our Lottie Moon missionary offering that will be received next Sunday and the following Sunday. So you actually have 2 weeks to pray over it and decide what God would have you to give. In this pamphlet, I want to draw our attention to the first day. So if you'll turn in this pamphlet to the second page, actually the third page, page 3 here, God's purpose, where it says right here, God's purpose. God's purpose, and they want us to be praying today to conquer lostness. And I want to draw your attention to the very last paragraph. We're going to pray for this just in a second here. I want to draw your attention to the very last paragraph. In that paragraph, it tells you that there are 3,500 plus IMB missionaries, 3,500 plus Southern Baptist missionaries. It doesn't account for all the other missionaries in the world, but 3,500 Southern Baptist missionaries. But I also want you to understand that they're asking us to pray for this number, because this number is amazing when you look at it and you think about it. 157,690 people die daily without knowing Jesus Christ. 157,690 people die daily. And Jesus isn't asking us to tell every single one of them. He's just asking us to tell one. Just tell. Just tell people about the Lord Jesus Christ. People are dying. Now think about that when I read about and I hear about arguments that go on in churches and problems that happen, and people are so involved with their own life that they forget about the fact that every second they take, somebody else is dying and going to hell. Let this idea of evangelism consume us, because we live in a lost world and people are dying every single day. 157,690 every single day. So let's pray for these missionaries, but let us also pray that we would be the missionaries right where we are. Because when you leave here today, you're going to walk out and underneath a sign that says you are now entering into the mission field. And let that thought stay with you and float with you throughout the week as you go about your normal activities. All right, Father, thank you for our missionaries that we support with our giving through the cooperative program. Lord, over 3,500 of them, 3,500 plus of them that are all over the world. And some in places that we can't even talk about. Now, Father, I pray that you would, first of all, continue to give them a desire to serve you. And then, Father, meet their needs. Meet their needs, wherever they are, so that they can be better missionaries for the kingdom of God. And then, Lord, remind us that we live in a lost and dying world that is hurting. Lord, our world is sick. And every day, there are people who die and spend eternity in hell because they have rejected you or have never heard of you. And so I pray that, Father, you would remind us through this Christmas season to be mindful of who you are and to be your witnesses among our family, our coworkers, our friends, our neighbors, that you would be glorified and you would be lifted on high. Father, thank you for this. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. All right, in 1 Peter chapter 3, I'm going to ask you some questions this morning. I hope you know the answers to these. They're pretty simple questions. So there's this phrase, life, liberty, and the pursuit of, where do you find that? Declaration of Independence, right? All right, so in that Declaration of Independence, we are told by the author, Thomas Jefferson, that we have been given unalienable rights. Who's given you those rights? God. And it actually says that you have been given those rights by God, right? I mean, it's amazing. And so what's happened is for many over the years, those ideas have meant that they had the right to gather all the stuff they could, and that would bring them happiness. So they spent their lives chasing after the American dream, only to find out that all of that stuff didn't bring them life, liberty, or the pursuit of happiness. So they chased after other things: alcohol, drugs, sex, rock and roll. And the sad reality of all of this is those things bring you a temporary rush that fall short of the genuine good life that really satisfies the heart and really satisfies the soul. America is sick and dying. And the reason that we are sick and dying is because we have pursued after the gods of hedonism, pleasure, and comfort. Murdering children is being done in a mother's womb, and they say it's for health care, but in reality it's not for health care. It's so that they can be out of the accountability of raising a child and being responsible for that child, and so that they can go back and pleasure themselves more. And so we are sick. There was a perfect example of a person who lived a hedonistic lifestyle, and his name was Ernest Hemingway. You feel familiar with Ernest Hemingway, right? He was a famous novelist. His literary talent brought him fame, prestige, money, allowed him to seek pleasure all over the world through hunting and fishing and parties and gatherings and drinking and fighting. And he went to several wars and reported on the wars and revolutions, and he slept with every woman that he could. And however, none of that gave him any lasting, genuine satisfaction. And in 1961, what did he do? He committed suicide. That was the hedonistic lifestyle he lived. And Scripture is full of men who pursued the good life in all the wrong places. And a perfect example in Scripture is Solomon. He had horses and gold and silver and land and chariots and women. He was king over Israel. He had power, he had influence, and he seemed to possess everything that makes up the good life. And in fact, when the Queen of Sheba visited him and observed his immense wealth and power, imposing presence, she was breathless. But toward the end of his life, he wrote a little book called Ecclesiastes. And in there he said, "I hated life, for the work which had been done under the sun was grievous to me, because everything is futility and striving after wind." He came to realize the good life is not found in things. It's not found in stuff. It's not found in education. It's not found in great accomplishments. It's not found in pleasure. What he found at the end of life was a sobering conclusion. Life was really more oppressive than good. Isn't that exciting? Isn't that great? I mean, that should get your motor going. Man, that's, you know what? As believers, we should love the life that God has granted to us every single day. Not take it for granted. Enjoy the goodness of every day. Stop. There's an old song. Stop and smell the roses. You may not like roses, but stop and smell the wild flowers and the life. And we just came through a beautiful season with the trees changed. Right? I mean, it was beautiful. Every day. And this morning when I got up, it was raining. When you got up, the sun was shining four hours after I did. It was raining when you got up. It was a rainbow. Oh, there we go. See? And there's all... I didn't get to see that. There's all these things that we take for granted. Peter recognized believers, as believers, we are not exempt from trials. We're not exempt from struggles that steal our joy. We are just aliens in an aggressive, hostile society, making persecution and suffering an integral part of living in this ungodly environment. And so he's going to conclude his discussion that he's started talking about in chapter 2, verse 11. He's going to conclude this discussion today discussing about how the Christian's conduct. And he's going to look at verse 8. He's going to start by saying this word, finally. What does he mean by finally? He means this: to sum it up. Okay? To sum everything up. After specific references to civil authority and our responsibility to them, and to employer-employee relationship and our responsibility there, and last week where we got to talk about unsaved spouse versus a saved spouse and her responsibility to him and his responsibility as well. After we get through all of that, he comes down to this section, 8 through 17, and he says, finally, let me sum it up. It's too much to address all of it, so let me just sum up what I'm actually going to tell you. And he's going to give us some general encouragement, some general exhortation, some general ways that we should live our life, which will open us up to the blessing that God desires all of us to enjoy. All right? So that sounds a little bit more exciting, right, than living with Ernest Hemingway's way of life, right? So let's grab our Bibles. Stand with me. We're going to read the first 17 verses of chapter 3. I will read the odd, you read the even in the New King James Version or off the screen. All right, beginning at verse 1. Wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they without a word may be won by the conduct of their wives. Do not let your adornment be merely outward, arranging the hair, wearing gold, or putting on fine apparel.
Practice how you live in person and heart, with
For in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God also ordained themselves, being submissive to their own husbands. Husbands likewise dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. Not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you are called to this, that you may inherit a blessing. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with the meekness and fear. For it is better if it is the will of God to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the reading of your word. Add your blessing to it, Father. I pray that as we look into your word today, Father, that you would encourage us to remain faithful in these last days, to remain close to you and understand that you are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and that we are to trust you, and not on our own understanding, but in all our ways acknowledge that who you are and how great you are. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for dying on the cross for our sin. And Father, I pray that if there's one here who doesn't know that they are saved, that today would be their day of salvation. We give you the praise in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. All right, you can be seated. We're going to go ahead and go to the next slide, brother. So let me just give you a backdrop a little bit on what's going on here. This is going to tie in as we go. Peter is writing this book to believers that are dispersed all over what we call today Turkey. All right, so they're dispersed all over this area of Turkey. And the reason they're dispersed and they're running for their life is because Nero has become Caesar. And Nero is a crazy lunatic of a person. And he has decided that he is going to set fire to his own city of Rome, especially the older section, because he wants to rebuild it and make a legacy, make a name for himself, okay? And so he's going to do this. He's insecure, so he sets fire to his town, and in so doing, people start to turn and say, Nero did it. And when they start to turn and say, Nero did it, guess what happens? He blames the Christians. He blames the Christians. It's the Christians' fault. If they would just listen and they don't want me to be king, they don't want me to be the Caesar, so they set fire over this, so they find this one group. When you're a politician and you cause the problem, that's what you do. You change the narrative, okay? And that's what he does. He's blaming others. And so the Christians are being dispersed. As they're being dispersed, many of them are being caught, and they are being tortured, and they are being persecuted, and many of them are being put to death. And so Peter is writing them, and he writes them in the first section, and he says, listen, suffering Christians need to remember that you have a great salvation. You have an expectant hope. You have a living hope. You have a triumphant entrance into glory, and that great hope is the Lord Jesus Christ. And you are to live for him no matter what comes. Second part, what we're going through right now, is suffering Christians should remember their example before men. We should remember our example before men. And he's given us some things to remember specifically that we are to be submissive. We are to be submissive to authority. We are to be submissive to those who are over us in the workplace, and we are to be submissive to each other, wives and husbands. We are to be submissive to one another, being under, being loving and gracious to those that we are over as that we are over as well. And so now he comes to this section. And it's really two sections in, that we're going to tie in together. And the first section deals with living and loving the good life, verses 8 through 12. We're called to be a blessing. We are called to be the blessing. And it says, and in verse 8, he's telling us we need to have the right attitude. He says, finally, brethren, finally, all of you be of one mind. All of you be of one mind. All of you have compassion for one another. All of you love as brothers. All of you be tenderhearted. All of you be courteous. So he says five things in there that we're supposed to do, five spiritual values. First of all, he tells us that we are to be harmonious. We are to be harmonious. He says, finally, all of you be of one mind. And that word, one mind, literally means same think. Same think. Same think about what? Your favorite football team? That hunting is the best sport there is? That everybody should enjoy Sloppy Joes? Is that what he's saying? No. We are to have the same think as Christ did. We are to, Paul said it differently, we are to have that, let this same mind be in you as was in Christ Jesus, your Lord. Make that your mind. Make that be your thing, that what you're thinking about, the inward unity of heart, having a common commitment. What is our common commitment to? The truth of the gospel. Okay? We are to be commonly committed to the truth of the gospel. Do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? Do you believe that he is not only God's Son, but he came and paid for your sin on the cross? Do you believe that he was buried? Do you believe that 3 days later he rose again? Do you believe that 40 days after that he ascended to the Father and he sits at the right hand of God the Father? That's what we are to believe in common. That's what the same think that he's talking about. Be harmonious. Let this mind drive you. Let this mind drive you. The second thing he says is be sympathetic. It means share the same feeling. We're to be united on the truth, but we're also to sympathize with those who are in pain. That's not only just for those brothers and sisters in Christ. Those are for those outside of Christ. We need to be sensitive, not insensitive or indifferent toward people that are struggling and people that are hurting. Thirdly, he says, have compassion, be of one mind, have compassion for one another, love as brothers. The word there is phileo. To have affection among people who are closely related to some in some way. Those who demonstrate that affection will do so by an unselfish service for one another. That is a service that belongs in the church. That you work in the church and you serve in the church because you want to help your brothers and sisters in Christ. And then that attitude should extend out into the world. Right? Brotherly. The next word he uses there in verse 8 is be tender-hearted or be kind-hearted. And the root word refers to your internal organs. Sometimes translated your bowels or your intestines, your affections. That they believed in that day that your affections came from the inside of your bowels and your intestines. And so the word means that you feel the pain of others deeply. You follow your Lord's example, who over and over and over and over in the Gospels, when you're reading about Jesus, it said Jesus was moved with compassion. And that's what that word means. So as we're living this life, we have to understand that we need to be harmonious, we need to be sympathetic, we need to be brotherly, we need to be kind-hearted, but we also need to be humble in spirit. That word humility is arguably the most essential, all-encompassing virtue of the Christian life. I used to have a friend that would say that that's what he was most proudest of, was his humility. Paul says, do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but have humility of mind regarding one another. Others are more important than you. That's the mentality that Paul says that we need to have. And so he says the joys of our lives in Christ are maximized when believers become united in truth and life, and they are peaceful in their disposition. They are gracious toward those who need the gospel. They are sensitive to the pains of fallen sinners, and they are sacrificial in loving services to all, compassionate and humble, just like our Savior. That will help you to live the life that Christ wants you to live when you have an attitude like that. But Peter doesn't stop there. He goes on and he says to have the right response. Look at verse 9. Not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you were called to this, that you may inherit a blessing. We need to have the same mind in us that Christ has when he was being persecuted, when he was being tortured, when he was being crucified. On the way up to Michigan, we got off on this one part because of the interstate was blocked. There was a lot of traffic going on. Heading north. And so we got off. We went on this side road. Lisa's really good at this. She finds roads on the side, and we go off on the side. And so we're traveling up on the side. We come to this roundabout. Y'all know what a roundabout is, right? So we come to this roundabout, and she's like, go to the second one. So there's three lanes at this stop sign or yield sign at this roundabout. The first lane is to go in the middle. The second lane is to go straight ahead. And the third lane is turned to the right. So I get in the middle lane, because I'm going to go around and then get off on the second one. And I get off, and I start going, and Lisa goes, ah! And I go, what? And this car, this moron, comes zooming around me and cuts me off. Got his license in Ohio. I was like, you got to be kidding me. And I was like livid. I was like, I'm going after him, you know. We're going to pull him over. We're going to run him down. And then reality hit, and I was like, I'm not doing anything. Just go on, moron. Kill yourself, you know. I hope you know Jesus. God bless you. Hope you know Jesus. Isn't that our reaction? All right, raise your hand. How many of you ever felt that way? Come on, be honest. The rest of you that don't have your hands up, you're a bunch of liars. You know, there was an incident that took place here just recently, a terrible incident out in Colorado. Y'all heard about it, right? Where a man went into a homosexual club at night and shot some people, killed some people, only to find out that the guy believes that he's binary, whatever that is. He's not male, he's not female, we don't know. Do you know what the press and the people in that area are blaming? It's the Christians' fault. It's the Christians' fault. Because they promote and say that homosexuality is a sin. Well, it is. But do you know what they did in response? They spray painted and vandalized part of Focus on the Family. If you're not familiar with that, Focus on the Family, their headquarters there in Colorado, and they did some damage to it. You know what the people in Focus on the Family did? They said, we need to love one another and show true love to one another and pray for these people that are doing this damage. That's the response that Christians need to have. It's not the response of having, you know, the wrong response and going after them. So number two is having the right response, because evil comes from an inherent quality of badness. You know, it's not just bad words, it's not just bad actions. When we are mistreated by someone who has a wicked disposition, we must not retaliate. We need to have the same attitude as Peter and John had when they put them in prison and they got out of prison. They're like, hey, we count it a privilege to be able to have been persecuted for the cause of Christ. Right? My mom reminded me of this statement this week when we were talking about some things. Two wrongs never make it right. Right? She's told me that all my life. Two wrongs never make it right. It's bothered me all my life. Not really. Peter says, you know, watch our speech. Watch our speech. Don't return insult for insult. Don't curse at them. Don't speak evil of them. Don't engage in vengeance. That's not an acceptable response for believers. God says, vengeance is mine. Wait on him. And so rather than retaliating, believers are to respond by giving a blessing. Look again what he says in verse 9. Not return evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, blessing. Knowing that you were called to this, that you may inherit a blessing. A blessing, a eulogy. It means to speak well of others. Speak well of others. That guy that cut me off, praise Jesus that he didn't kill anybody. Right? Bless people. Bless people. Love them unconditionally. Bless them by praying for their salvation. Or if they're saved, bless them by praying for their sanctification. Bless them by expressing gratitude for them. And finally, and most crucial, believers are to forgive. Forgive those who persecute you. Forgive those who cut you off. Father, forgive them. I love the last part of that. They know not what they do. Peter makes it clear. We have been called for this purpose, that we might inherit, freely receive a blessing. Don't retaliate. Bless. Number three is have the right standard. Verse 10 and 11, he goes on to say, for he who would love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. What is our standard? The standard is the Word of God. The Word of God is Jesus. Okay? That is our standard. And that's what we are to live by. That's what we are to live our life by. And Peter illustrates that principle by quoting from a psalm to defend what he just taught. A Christian described here as the one who desires to love and see good days. We must refrain from speaking anything that comes from underlying evil out of an immoral disposition in our life. We are to refrain from verbally retaliating. We must stop our lips from speaking deceit. We must be committed to truth. in this days. We must be opposed to lying, deception, and hypocrisy. That means turn off the news. Don't listen to the politicians. Get into the Word of God. This is your standard. If you're getting your standard from the news media, you're lost. You're being deceived. Get it from the Word of God. Jesus said, "For the mouth speaks out of that which fills the heart." Verse 11 is actually from Psalm 34, 14. And verse 11 gives us four straightforward commands. Turn away from evil. That means strongly reject what is sinful. You're told you have to believe all this stuff. No, you don't. If it goes against the Word of God, you do not have to believe it. You do not have to live your life by it. You reject it because it's not truth. You reject what is sinful. Secondly, Peter says, do good. What is excellent in quality? What expresses deep down virtue? That goes against what our world says. Our world says, do what feels good, or do your own thing, right? Our worldview comes from the Word of God, and we are to do good and not do what we want to do. Many of the things that we want to do are not good. Many of the things that people do are not good. We are not to do those. And then the third and fourth principle actually appear to be together, and it's seek and pursue peace. Seek and pursue peace. Seek and pursue are verbs, which means it's an action. It means you need to look after it. You need to go after it. You need to have an intensity and an aggressiveness of action. The word peace means there's a constant condition of tranquility. How many of you love peace? You'd like to have peace in your life, right? Right? Isn't that what we're after? Isn't that what Christmas is about too? To have peace on earth, goodwill toward men? It just doesn't come naturally. We have to work at peace in our life. Hunt for it aggressively. And that means even peace with those who persecute you. Peace who you don't agree with. Peace that with people who don't know Jesus Christ. Strive for harmony. Number four, we need to have the right incentive. Verse 12. The right incentive. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, his ears are open to their prayers, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. This comes from Psalm 34, verse 25 and 26, and it fixes the reality that ought to motivate us to live lives that are pleasing to God. This psalm describes a sovereign, ruling God who sees all and knows all, who holds people accountable for their behavior, and threatens punishment for disobedience. Kind of reminds me of Santa Claus. He knows when you're awake. He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows if you've been good or bad, so be good for goodness sake. Only our God is much greater than Santa Claus. And so for Peter, the primary issue here is not judgment, but it's God's gracious care for his people. Look at that verse again. Look at what it tells us. He says, for the eyes of the Lord. That's a common Old Testament phrase that relates to God's special caring watchfulness over his people. And sometimes that phrase indicates God's judgmental watchfulness, but the emphasis here is that he is omniscient. He sees all. He is aware. He is aware of everything going on in your life. when the struggles are happening and when you don't feel like you, things are being fair to you, he sees it. He knows it. He's looking toward the righteous so that he can listen to and attend to our prayer. Then the rest of that verse, he also talks about in there, his ears are open. He wants to hear. He wants us to pray. He wants us to seek him. But look at the rest of that verse. The face is of the Lord is against those who do evil. His wrath is not against those who have received Jesus Christ as their Savior. Isn't that good to know? Yeah? It's not against you if you know Jesus as your Savior. His wrath is against those who do evil. You say, well, Pastor Kevin, how come he allows so much evil in the world? That's a great question. We don't have time for that today. But let me give you the answer in a nutshell so it'll help you out. He allows it to grow you to be the person that he wants you to be. He allows it to bring others to him. He allows the evil to go for that purpose. But if you reject his eternal gift of eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ, his wrath is against you. And followers today or in Peter's time have always had to contend with a hostile world. But they can live humbly, respond to persecution in a Christ-like manner, and cling to the standard that God has given to us, because we have the promise that even in the midst of trying circumstances, God is watching over them. God is protecting them. And God is ready to extend his blessing. Today, there is an escalating hostility toward biblical Christianity. When you look at this on the first page, it tells you where all our many of our missionaries are. There's some in here that don't tell you where they are. There'll be many that even when they go through their training, when they tell you who they are, they won't use their real name. When we were at the convention, we ran into a man who's in another country, but he won't tell you he won't go by his real name. He asks you to call him something else, it's to protect him. It's to protect his family. And so that's what we would do. There is hostility today. It is out there. It is old. Francis Schaeffer, I don't know if you ever heard of Francis Schaeffer, but he wrote this book. It's called How Should We Then Live? He wrote that book in 1976. And in that book, he says this, quote, "In ancient Israel, when the nation had turned from God and from his truth and commands as given in Scripture, the prophet Jeremiah cried out that there was death in the city. He was speaking not only of physical death in Jerusalem, but also a wider death, because Jewish society of that day had turned away from what God had given them in the Scripture. There was death in the polis, that is, there was death in the culture and in the total society." He goes on to say, "In our era, 1970s, sociologically, man destroyed the base which gave him the possibility of freedom without chaos. Humanists have been determined to beat to death the knowledge of God and the knowledge that God has not been silent, but is spoken in the Bible and through Christ, and they have been determined to do this even though the death of values has come with a death of that knowledge," end quote. That's an amazing quote that was written in 1976, 200 years after America was founded. And now here it is, 2022, almost 2023. You do Fred's math and figure out how old America is, but we are on the doorstep of death because we have turned our back on God. Believers in Peter's day lived in Rome in a Roman Empire that Schaeffer referred to as facing all of the same kind of degeneracy and depravity that assault today's church. In some parts of the world, there is direct persecution of believers. And it is coming here very quickly. I told you last week, I'll tell you again this week, there is a bill going into the Senate that it looks really good because it's going to protect marriage. But what it does is it protects anything but marriage designed by God. That means that if there is a person who comes into this church that wants to be married and they are homosexual and they want to marry their homosexual partner, that if I don't do it, I can be put in jail. So I hope you'd like to come visit me in jail, or you at least bail me out of jail, or at least bring me a cake with a file in it, one or the other. Direct persecution for those who believe in Jesus Christ is coming down the pike, and we better be ready for it. And so with that in mind, the rest of this, he gives us security against the hostile world. He gives us five principles that believers need to embrace to equip ourselves, to defend ourselves against the threat of an unbelieving, hostile world. The first one is that we need to have, man, he put him up there, he is quick. We need to have a passion for goodness. Look at verse 13. Who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? This is a rhetorical question. It's proving that it is unusual for people to do harm to those who do good. That is what used to happen in society. If you did good, people usually protected you. If you were doing something good, people usually helped you. Today, if you're doing good and people come against you to do evil against you, they're not going to help you, they're going to film it. Don't ever let me catch you filming something when you should be helping someone. Please don't let me ever do that. We live in a world that is full of people with reprobate minds, and they will not hesitate to harm those who do good. Our job as a believer is to do just that. Do good. Be zealous to do what is right. Be zealous to live a godly life, no matter what other people say about you. The idea of being zealous is that of being enthusiastic. Be enthusiastic for a cause. The cause is that of Jesus Christ. The cause is that of the gospel. We should be enthusiastic to do good. Right? Did it not warm your soul to see 1,367 shoeboxes, knowing that they're going to some children who may never hear the name Jesus Christ and their families? That is awesome. Does it not help you to be excited that, was it last weekend, 2 weekends ago, you handed out 11 boxes of food to people in our area? Doing that is great. To hand out clothing to people who may need it, may not, but just giving it away. That should encourage you. That same attitude should encourage you to give away the gospel. To give away the gospel and to be zealous to do good. In other words, you need to have a passion to do good, to help others. The second thing he tells us in verse 14 and 17 is a willingness to suffer for wrong and for right. Look at verse 14. He says, even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. In verse 17, for it's better if it is the will of God to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. Just because you have a passion for doing what's good does not guarantee you against suffering. It may only make it more unlikely or less frequent. Listen, we're told in the gospel, Jesus went about going around doing what? doing good, right? He went about doing good. He went about helping other people. He went about doing it. And what did this hostile world do to him? They crucified him. If they crucified him, what makes us think they're not going to turn against us if we do good, right? And so that we need to keep that in mind. And many of Peter's readers would go in, they would suffer for righteousness. They would suffer for righteousness. They were upright. They did good. They did godly behavior. And so faithful Christians today should not be surprised or afraid if their goodness and doing good brings suffering to them. In fact, you should have the same attitude that Peter talks about in 1 Peter 5, verse 10, where he says, "But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you." In other words, you should expect it. You go about doing good, you should expect that you may come into problems and trials. And so this whole idea comes from Isaiah chapter 8, where we're told not to fear what they fear or be in dread of it. If the Lord of hosts, whom you should regard as holy, and he shall be your fear, and he shall be your dread. And there's a historical setting with that in those verses, that there was an impeding invasion by Assyria and into Judah. And king of Judah at that time was Ahaz, and he was facing this crisis. The king of Israel and the king of Syria had come together and made an alliance, and they had formed their forces together, and they were going to go up against and invade Judah. And Ahaz, he had come together and tried to get Judah to align with Syria. And when he did that, Isaiah warns him not to have an ungodly alliance and told him, don't be afraid. Ahaz and the people of Judah were not to fear Assyria and Syria and Israel did, but rather they were to fear the Lord. We are to fear the Lord. We are to put our trust in the Lord and not other people and not other things. And so when we look at this, we need to look at this verse and understand that followers of Jesus Christ need to be willing to suffer for two possibilities. First, by doing what was right. We accept the pain as part of God's wise, sovereign plan by doing what is right for blessing our lives. And then secondly, we may suffer for doing what is wrong. And that suffering may be designed simply to just receive the discipline of the Lord. When I do what is wrong, I need to understand I need to be disciplined by the Father. Today I believe that there are many things that are happening in our lands today, in our land today, because we, the believers, did not obey the Father, and we allowed the evil one to have a foothold. And because of that, we are being disciplined. We suffer for the sake of righteousness when God wants us to. God never wants us to sin. Number 3, verse 15. So we need to have a devotion to Jesus. He says, "But sanctify Christ as Lord in your heart." Sanctify Christ in our hearts. When we do that, we affirm our submission to his control. We affirm our submission to his instruction. We affirm our submission to his guidance. And we declare and submit to God's sovereign majesty. We, in essence, we look at him and we sanctify him and we say, "God, you are God, and I am not. God, you are God, and I am not." And literally that word sanctify means to set apart, to consecrate. In this context, it also means giving the primary place of adoration. of exaltation, of worship to Jesus. Believers who sanctify Christ set him apart from all others as a sole object of their love, their reverence, their loyalty, and their obedience. They recognize that he is perfect. He is glorious. He is preeminent. And we are submitting ourselves to your will. In essence, we are saying to him, you are master. You are Lord of my life, and I am not. And by honoring of Christ is not external, but it's in the heart. Even when they must face unjust suffering, they submit to him as Lord. Number four, you have a readiness to defend the gospel. He says, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and in fear. The Greek term for defense is the word apologia. It's where we get our word apology or apologetics. It often means a formal defense in a judicial courtroom. Paul used the word informally to denote his ability to answer those who question him. And he says, Peter says, always, always be ready. Always be prepared. Always be ready to respond, whether in a courtroom or in a classroom. Respond to everyone who asks you to give an account. Why do you believe the way you believe? Why do you live the way you live? Why do you attend church on Sunday morning when you could be doing something else? Those are answers you need to have readily available and on the tip of your tongue, even though it may not spell right, or sound right. Have it ready for those who are going to ask you those questions. Be ready with the gospel. Be ready with the message, because the gospel is the hope for all. It is the hope of this world. Hope is our faith. It is our motive. It is what keeps us not only from escaping hell and going to heaven, but to live a life that is joyful in this world, even though people may be against us. The believer must give this defense, how Peter says, with gentleness and reverence. Gentleness means meekness or humility, not in the sense of weakness, but in the sense of not being dominant or overbearing. Speak truth. Speak truth in love. The reverence expresses that you are devoted to God. Why do I do this? Because I have a deep regard for His truth. I have a deep regard for who He is. I have a deep regard for what He has done for me. Nothing worse than a Christian who is presenting a biblical account of their salvation and they are insecure in what they believe. It does way too much damage to the gospel. Know what you believe, know why you believe, and be ready to share it with others. Number five is that you have a pure conscience. Verse 16. Having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. The conscience is the soul reflecting on itself. Both the Greek and the English word conscience have the idea of knowing oneself. The conscience is not Jiminy Cricket. It is not, some of you are like, who's that? Look it up. Google it. The conscience is not the voice of God. It's not even the moral law. It is the human faculty which educates upon human action by the light of the highest standard a person perceives. In other words, a good conscience is what every follower of Christ needs to have, needs to keep, and needs to maintain. A conscience allows believers to be free from any burden of guilt as they face hostility and criticism from this world. When you're slandered, believers ought to be able to agree with the Apostle Paul, who says, I also do my best to maintain always a blameless conscience, both before God and before men. Slandered believers who maintain good behavior in Jesus will have their consciences at rest, untroubled by guilt, and their godly lives will prove any criticisms from unbelievers to be false. The word revile means to threaten, to insult, or mistreat. What do you do when people mistreat you, when they insult you? If you have a pure conscience, it can help you withstand and deflect whatever abusive, insulting speech the world hurls at you. So years ago, when I was younger and dumber, I was a soccer coach. And I coached middle school. And 3 years, I think I coached them. And then I ended up coaching Brandon, assistant coach, Brandon's senior year. And there was a young man on the team that was a year behind Brandon, who was a decent soccer player, but not a great soccer player. But he was very, very energetic. And so in the middle school, I didn't start him, but I had him come off the bench because he was very energetic and ran up and down and acted like a crazy man, and I loved that. I loved watching him do that. So I didn't start him. So that was, he was in 7th grade then, 8th grade, he was in 8th grade then. 3 years later, getting kids off the field, head coach over here talking to someone, and I'm standing there with Brandon and one of his friends, and his friend leaves. I'm like, are you ready? And he's like, yeah. He's always slow to get off the stuff. He loved being on the field. So I thought we were going to go, and all of a sudden, here comes this kid's dad. And just chewed me up one side and down the other. And near the end of it, he called me Satan. Because Satan has a goatee. And I wanted to ask him, when did you see Satan? Have you been face to face with him? But I didn't say anything. And he just chewed me up 15 minutes. And the head coach was over there just watching. And I just stood there and let him go. Because in my own heart and in my own mind, I knew I'd done nothing wrong. He left. The next day I sat that boy down and I talked with him. And we were cool after that. There are times in our life where people are going to attack us and abuse us. How are you going to respond when that happens? Right? How are you going to respond when that happens? That will show you, that will show others what you believe and why you believe it. The things of God are more important. The Puritan minister Thomas Watson wrote these words, and with this we'll close. He said, afflictions work for good as they make way for glory. Not that they merit glory, but they prepare for it. As plowing prepares the earth for a crop, so afflictions prepare and make us ready for glory. The painter lays his gold upon dark colors. So God first lays the dark colors of affliction, and then he lays the gold color of glory. The vessel is first seasoned before wine is poured into it. The vessels of mercy are first seasoned with affliction, and then the wine of glory is poured in it. Thus we see afflictions are not prejudicial, but beneficial to the saint. Stephen is a perfect example of that. His character was flawless. He showed the love of God to others, and they murdered him. And even while he was dying, he said, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." Is that your heart attitude? Let's pray. As we looked into this deep portion of Scripture, there's a lot in there. But Peter wants us to have the right attitude when we come to suffering and persecution and trials and things that happen in our life. I don't know where you are spiritually with this, but I know there's times where I struggle with people that are unfair and cruel. And I've had to ask forgiveness. And maybe you're in the same predicament, or maybe some other situation, but there's something going on in your life. You say, "Pastor, just pray for me." Nobody looking around, just slip your hand up. "I know Jesus, but I just have issues." Yeah, God bless you all. Bless you all. Yes, yes. Christ went through the cruelest, most horrible events when he went to the cross for us. And maybe you're here today and you'd never received Jesus as your Savior. This morning, why not in the quietness of this time, just look inside your heart. Ask him to come into your heart, come into your life, and save you. Excuse me. Father, I pray that today, as we've looked into this scripture, that, Lord, you'd remind us that when we go through the hard times and the struggles, that, Lord, you're just perfecting us. You're just making us look more like Jesus. And that you would remind us that as we go through these, that there's glory ahead. And that we are to look forward to them and to ask forgiveness for those who would use us or be cruel to us. That we would forgive them and that we would show them the love of Christ. Lord, thank you for your mercy and thank you for your tenderness. God, you are so good to us. Have your way in our hearts and lives and help us, Father, to walk closer to you. And Lord, we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, a couple of announcements. You are so quiet today. Don't forget, Lottie Moon is this week. If you're interested in helping with a Christmas float, when is that? Saturday the 10th? Yes. Saturday the 10th is Christmas parade. Okay, so if you need help, and if you're interested in helping build that, see Sharon. You're building it this week? John built it this week?
Okay, so we have to decorate it and everything.
Okay. John's all right, isn't he?
I know, I kind
of
like him.
Danielle said she'll keep him for another year. Got one more year. Good grace, brother. Ladies, ornament exchange is this Friday. We got ours this weekend. We as in Lisa got hers this weekend. We went to this place called Bronner's up in Michigan. It's two football field buildings put together of just nothing but Christmas ornaments. I'm not going to tell you what she got. we went on Good Friday. She got an ornament. We went on Good Friday, and it was wall-to-wall people. Crazy, right? I drove around for 10 minutes trying to find a parking spot. Anyway, there's a sign-up sheet back there. Sign up. Make sure you bring something really good to eat. Awana Mismatched Night is coming up December 7th. Food Pantry is the 9th and the 10th that weekend. Man, we got everything going on that weekend. That's also the weekend we're going to Charlotte, those that are going. And then that Sunday, all right, the 11th, put this down in your calendar, the 11th, 1 week, not this Sunday, but the next week, we're going to do the Christmas again from the daycare. They're going to come up and sing a few songs, and I don't know what they're going to do, sing and dance and be crazy. Who knows? We don't know. I don't know that I want to know, but they're going to do some things, and then after that, we're going to have a meal downstairs, all right? And they're asking us to bring dessert. Now, somebody sign my wife up and put cheesy potatoes. That is not a dessert. We won't mention Jenny's name because she's not here. But bring a dessert, okay? If you don't know what a dessert is, ask a man. They'll tell you. Daycare, that's coming up. So that's going to be on the 11th. We will have a service on Christmas morning. Normal time, normal bat station, normal bat time. What are you looking at me like that? 10:30, normal time. And then this Monday, tomorrow, is men's Bible study.
Yeah, it's a great time for somebody that hasn't been to be here because we're starting a brand new book.
A new book.
At the very beginning.
Right. We're going back to the beginning. And starting at Genesis, so if you've never been or haven't been in a while, it's a great time to start the book of Genesis. All you got to do before now and tomorrow night is read the whole book. No. Just come. Just come. Bring questions. And Fred will answer them. As best you can. All right? Anything else?
Small groups
tonight, 5 o'clock. Prayer request. Ooh, what's his name?
Kevin.
That's a good name. So pray for Kevin. So remember Carol, she had some biopsies done, and then her son-in-law, Kevin, with his problem with liver. Yeah. Okay. Anything else? Okay. Can you go in the third for a CT scan? Okay. Judy?
Yes, sir.
How are you?
I'm good.
Good. Nice color.
Thank you.
Yeah. Right?
Dave O'Brien.
Dave O'Brien. Okay. 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 Yep. All right, Kelly. Okay, unspoken. Sharon. Okay. So remember, Perry, as he prepares for surgery on Wednesday. That's what it is. Just look at the way it's spelled out. Wednesday. All right. Anything else? Ready to go? If you're ready to go, please stand. We'll sing the doxology, and then Elijah will dismiss us in prayer. Go ahead.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.